If you would turn your Bibles to 2 Kings chapter 4. If you would please stand with me for the reading and the reverence of God's word, that's 2 Kings chapter 4. I'll be reading from the NIV translation, and you can follow along with the translation you may have. If you have it, say amen. And it reads, "The wife of a man from the company of the prophets cried out to Elisha, 'Your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that he revered the Lord. But now his creditor is coming to take my two boys as his slaves.' Elisha replied to her, 'How can I help you? Tell me, what do you have in your house?' 'Your servant has nothing there at all,' she said, 'except,'" someone say except.
Except.
"A small jar of olive oil." Elisha said, "Go around to all your neighbors for empty jars. Don't ask for just a few. Then go inside and shut the door behind you and your sons. Pour oil into all the jars, and as each is filled, put it to one side." She left him and shut the door behind her and her sons. They brought the jars to her, and she kept pouring. Someone said kept pouring.
Kept pouring.
When all the jars were full, she said to her son, "Bring me another one." But he replied, "There is not a jar left." Then the oil stopped flowing. Someone say the word then.
Then.
She went and told the man of God, and he said, "Go, sell the oil and pay your debts. You and your sons can live on what is left." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. While you're taking your seat this morning, this is the first part to a sermon series that that God is leading me towards. It's called The Trust Factor. And today my sermon title is, "God is my provider." Let us pray. God, this is your moment. I am only the instrument that you chose to stand before your people. Stand up in me like you did in Moses and in Joshua and in Paul and Peter. Stand up in me so that your gospel and your good news, oh God, will be proclaimed throughout all the world. Now, God, if you do not speak, there is not a word to liberate us. Now, God, if you do not speak, oh God, shackles cannot be broken. God, if you do not speak, God, minds cannot be transformed. So, God, have your way in this moment. Use me, oh God. Crown me from the top of my head to the soles of my feet, oh God. And even if it's not written, oh God, my ears and my heart is open towards heaven, oh God. Speak in me, oh God, so that I may deliver a word to your people in this season. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God has an interesting way of providing for his children. One of the things I know about God is that God will use whatever resources necessary to meet our needs. I'll share this story with you. This was about a young lady. Each morning, a woman walked to her front gate and shouted, "Praise the Lord." And each time, the atheist next door to her would yell back, "There is no Lord." One day she prayed, "Lord, I'm hungry. Please send me some food." The following morning, she went out on her porch and she discovered there was a bag of groceries. And she shouted out again, "Praise the Lord." And suddenly, out of nowhere, the atheist jumped from behind the bush and said, "I told you there was no Lord. I bought those groceries for you." The woman said again, "Praise the Lord. You not only sent me groceries, but you made the devil pay for them too." God has an interesting way of making sure our needs are met. God will take whatever he has in order to make sure that we go, we have what we're able to, we have what we need. God is the only one that can take what appears to be a hopeless situation and miraculously turn it around for our good. God is the only one that can step right into your crisis and into the lives of those that are hurting and work things out for our good. Young people, only God can take difficult situations in your life. Only God can take those moments of darkness and turn around and turn the light on, and then there is day. God is the only one that can step in a season of not enough and supernaturally supply all our needs. Can I get a witness this morning? It was God who opened the doors and blessed you with a job you weren't qualified for. It was God who showed up at your school and allowed favor to fall upon teachers and they gave you a grade that you may not even deserve. It was God who showed up on your job, who told a boss to surrender themselves to the Holy Spirit, and what was a difficult day became a peaceful opportunity for God. The Bible says God's ways are not our ways, and God's thoughts are not our thoughts. Somebody could testify this morning that in the middle of a difficult situation, that God showed up and what seemed impossible became possible. Someone could testify this morning that when there were seasons of not enough, God showed up and made a way out of no way. Somebody say this morning, God is my provider. In the text, we encounter a woman who has reached the end of her rope. The Bible doesn't tell us her name. The Bible doesn't tell us where she's from. All we know is that she had a situation that was beyond her powers. She had a situation that no one in her family could give her a remedy to. She had a situation that she couldn't even log on to social media and someone give her a remedy for. She had a situation that she could not solve. All we know is that if you look and pull back the curtains of this time, she was in a patriarchal community. She had no one in her family that could give her the money. She had no male that could go to the gates and talk to the elders on her behalf. All she knew was her two sons' future was in jeopardy. And she knew that sitting home and feeling sorry for herself wasn't going to get it. She knew that questioning where was God was not going to give her the solution that she needed. She knew that waiting for someone else to fill this need, this void that she had, was not going to get it. She had a problem, people of God. But I came by to let someone know in this familiar text that in the natural, it appeared that there was no way out. In the natural, it appeared that the odds were stacked up against us. In the natural, it looked like the future of her sons would be gone. But if someone is honest this morning, you could testify that you've stood between a rock and a hard place, not knowing how God was going to show up and bring you out. If you would testify this morning, you would say that, me too, I've been in a place where I've been at my last and at my wit ends, and I didn't know what God was going to do in this season of my life. You would testify and say that I've had situations where the darkness seemed like it was my reality and my current lot, but somehow between a rock and a hard place and the darkness and light, God showed up in your situation. People of God, I came by to tell you this morning that when you've reached the end of you, that is a perfect opportunity for God to show up. When you've come to the end of your limits, that is an opportunity for God to show up and show you just how great he is. When you've reached the end of your statistical analysis of what could be and what is not, and the new math that they're teaching in schools does not add up, there is a God who will step in and turn your midnight into day. There is a God who will step right in and turn your situation all the way around. There is a God whose methods for problem solving are illogical. There is a God that who, no matter what you do and no matter what you put before him, that is not impossible for him. I don't know about you this morning, but that's good news. That's good news to know that when my back is against the wall, that God will and can show up in my situation and turn it all the way around. I don't know about you this morning, but that's good news that when the doctor gives me a report, I know there's a God that I can take it to, and he has the final and last word over who I am and what I am. I don't know about you this morning, church. But when someone speaks negative over my life, I can go to the God who created this life and say, no, that's not what God said about me, and I can keep walking in faith. That's good news this morning. The widow woman. She took her situation to the one she knew who had direct access to God. You see, that says a lot about how you get your problem solved and what to do when you're faced with a problem. Because, see, we've stopped turning our faces to God, and we've started looking for outsources. We've started looking for advice from social media. We started calling people on the phone and saying, tell me what you think about this. We've started having our pity parties and asking people to join us and get their input on how we should feel and what it looks like. But this widow woman, she took her problem to the man of God. She took her problem to the one who had direct access to God. So you see, I don't know what trial you walked in with this morning. I don't know what you may be facing in your personal life, but I came to tell somebody that trust God in spite of whatever it is that you're going through. I don't know what notices that keep showing up day after day after day after day after day after day after day at your house, but I came to tell someone that God is still a God who supplies all of our needs. I don't know what the doctor may have said about you when you went to your last appointment, but I came to let someone know that God is still a God who answers prayers. The widow woman, she took her problem to the one she knew that had an answer to her situation. Young people, I want to tell you that no matter what you face in life, there's nothing that's too hard for God. No matter what they say about you at school, keep your trust in God and believe that with God you can do anything. Regardless of what standardized test that they put before you and say that your life would be this, trust what God said about you. The widow woman, she took her problem to the prophet Elisha. This problem, this was a God-sized problem. This problem was way too big for the community leaders sitting at the gate. This problem needed a God solution. This problem didn't need a phone call to someone to tell them what's going on. This problem required something that only God could give. You see, this is the same Elisha who served the prophet Elijah. This is the same Elijah who picked up the mantle of Elijah after he was taken up to be with the Lord. This is the same Elijah who inherited a double portion of Elijah's spirit. God was with Elijah, just as God is with you. The power of God rested on Elijah. Elijah had so much power that when Elijah was taken up to be with the Lord, he took the mantle that Elijah wore, and when he got to the Jordan River, he didn't question about how I'm going to cross. He took the cloak of Elijah, and he hit the water with the cloak, and the Bible says that the water separated, and he walked through on dry ground. The Hebrew word for what the widow woman does in this text, the word, somebody say cried. Somebody say cried. The Hebrew word for that word cried is sayak. I'm teaching a little Hebrew this morning. Someone say sayak. You see, this is not just a regular cry. This is not just like tears flowing from your face. This was a cry of distress. This was a cry of I have an urgent need. This was a cry that, Lord, can you help me? This was a cry that, Lord, if you don't show up, I don't know what I'm going to do. This was a cry that, if you don't speak right now, Lord, my situation is hopeless. This was a cry that you cry in the midnight hour, and God hears your cry. This is the cry that in the midnight hours when tears are falling and your pillow is soaked, God is counting the tears that comes upon your face. This was the cry that the Hebrew woman took before Elijah. The Bible tells us this word for cry in the Hebrew is the same word that's used in Genesis chapter 4 when the Lord told Cain, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. This is the same translation for the word cry that Job used to describe his cry for judgment after he had lost everything. This woman, she had a problem. She broke cultural norms. She broke religious protocol to go to Elijah. Culture said, go to the city gate and present your case. Culture said, take your case before the king. Law codes say, you're a woman. You're not even supposed to be here. The law code says that your debtor is entitled to your son, but she needed a miracle. Someone say miracle this morning. She needed a miracle that only God could provide. She needed a solution that only God could give. Young people, when you're confronted with a crisis, it's good to have your BFFs, it's good to have your girls, it's good to have your boys, it's good to have your family and your parents praying for you, but I came to tell you, never forget to take it to God. Others may tell you to give up and throw in the towel, but never forget to take it to God. Others may tell you that there is no hope, but never forget to take it to God. Others may tell you, you'll never get out of this. I came to let you know, never forget to give it to God. Others may say that you're not going to make it. Others may say your situation is hopeless, but I came to let you know that if you trust in God, all things, somebody say all things, are possible with God. With God, what appears to be a lost cause, God can turn it around for your good. With God, what appears to be no hope, God can step in and restore hope. With God, what appears not to be enough, God would supernaturally step in and exceed your expectations. When she met Elijah, here's what I love about Elijah. See, when you go to God and when you take your problems before God, God doesn't waste time asking you questions about how did you get into this debt. God doesn't ask a question, did you have a committee meeting to get it approved in the first place? God doesn't say, did you pray and ask me, can you get it before I answer you? Elijah asked her, how can I help you? And what do you have in your house? I'm going to say that again. How can I help you? And what do you have in your house? But just like some of us, she started focusing on what her limitations were. She focused on what she saw in the natural. She focused on her limitations, not on God's possibilities. Her response to Elijah was, your servant has nothing at all. She was so restricted by her situation that she could not see beyond the reality that was in front of her. People of God, how can you stand before God and place limitations on God? How can you stand before God and know that you're in the presence of the Almighty One, you're in the presence of the Omniscient One, but yet your focus is on what you don't have? Negative talk convinced her that she had nothing. Her perspective of what she saw minimized her vision. But if some of us are honest this morning, there have been times in our lives where we've measured our problems based on our limited abilities. There have been times in our lives where we've allowed our distorted lenses to overtake our faith. And see, if I can paraphrase what Elijah said to her this morning, Elijah said, is there anything that God can use? Is there anything in the house that God can use? Asbury, is it anything in the house that God can use? Is there faith at least the size of a mustard seed to believe that God can turn it around? Is there a heart that still believes that nothing is too hard for God? Is there hope that sees the flicker of light in the midst of the darkness? Is there an ear that still hears the promises God spoke over your life? I came to let someone know that God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all you could think or imagine. God is able to turn this midnight into day. God is able to step into your situation and to meet all your needs. Someone say, God is able. Beloved, if your situation is going to change, there are two things that you need. The first thing you'll need is faith to move when the word has been spoken. Someone say faith. The Bible tells us when the widow woman initially stood before Elisha, her focus was on what she did not have. But somewhere between the cry for help and the questions, her "I have nothing" shifted to "I have a small jar of oil." The Bible doesn't waste time telling us what happened or how her mind changed or what mood was set in order to make the shift. But somewhere along the way, all we know is that her perspective of her situation began to change. She went from "I have nothing" to walking in faith. What started out as a nothing turned into something. And that's a word for someone this morning, that we need a faith that looks beyond what we see and meet God in the supernatural. We need a faith that says, "God, I don't know how you're going to do it, but I believe with you all things are possible." We need a faith that moves us beyond our place of nothingness and propels us to walk in faith. All God needs for a breakthrough in the house is just a little something, something. All God needs to turn your situation around is just a little something, something. All God needs for someone's life to be transformed is faith the size of a mustard seed. We serve a God that will take a little faith and multiply it and magnify it and do miraculous things. We serve a God that will take a little faith and turn your life upside down. When you trust that God will do it, God is the only one that can do it. When you trust God with whatever is going on in your life, God is the only one that can turn things around. Someone say, "Have a little faith." When Elijah spoke to the woman, she didn't waste time asking Elijah questions. You know, that's what we're sometimes guilty of. We want to know, how's it going to happen? Well, I told you I only had a little oil. What does that have to do with my sons? She didn't waste time questioning the prophet about how God was going to make this work. The Bible tells us that Elijah spoke, and she moved in faith. The Bible tells us when Elijah said, "Go," she put her faith into action. And so that's the word for someone, that God has said, "Go," but you're waiting for God to fill in the dots. God has said, "I'm going to bless you," but you're waiting for God to show you all the pieces to the puzzle. But God is saying, "Go." There's someone here that God has promised something, and you're waiting for God to fill in the rest of the picture. But God says, "Go." God said, when you start walking, when you start trusting me, when you start believing that everything that you're missing in the picture, God will begin to supernaturally manifest it along the way. God said, "Go." I'll share this with you. Rick Warren said, "The difference between faithful people and unfaithful people is unfaithful people give up at the first sign of difficulty. Faithful people keep on keeping on. Faithful people are determined. They're diligent. They're persistent. Faithful people don't know how to quit." Yeah, that's a word for somebody. Faithful people don't know how to quit. And so I don't know who this is for this morning, but there's something that has come up against you while you're walking toward the purpose that God has put upon your life. But God told me to tell you this morning that if you're faithful, you can't throw in the towel. If you're faithful, you can't quit at the first sign of trouble. If you're faithful, the lean season will overshadow, the lean season will pass. If you're faithful, God will be with you as you walk through this time. People of God, we must walk in faith. Even when we can't see what the end will be, we have to walk in faith, not knowing what God said. Dude, if God said go, that means he's already worked the middle out and you will get to your destination. If God says go, that means he's already figured out all the in between. You just keep on walking. You can't get tired. You can't quit in the midst of the journey. Keep walking and go. If your situation is going to change, there's something you need. The first thing was faith to move when the word is spoken. The second thing that you will need is to expect God's word to come true. Somebody say expectation. In the text, the woman and her sons took empty jars into their house, and she started to pour the oil. She expected God to do something different in her situation. She expected God to do something that no one else could do in her situation. As long as she had faith to believe, she expected God's word to be true. She believed, as long as she had something to pour, that the oil would keep flowing. Can't you see her as she filled those jars in her house, as she poured from this small jar and into another one, and she watches it fill? Can't you see her just pouring and the oil continue to flow? Can't you see her move one jar from here to there and ask her son to bring another? And as she poured from the small jar, she looks around the room and see all of these jars filled. Can't you see her trusting God and saying, God, I don't know how you're doing this, but you told me to keep pouring. And as long as I have empty vessels, I'm going to keep pouring. And as long as my son keeps bringing them to me, you said the oil will meet the need, so I'm going to just keep trusting you. Can't you see her? And I came to tell somebody this morning that as long as you continue to allow your vessel to be open, to be poured into by the Lord, that God will continue to fill you. As long as you continue to allow the hand of God to pour into your life, that God will continue to move. As long as you continue to leave room for God, and as you walk through this season of life, God will continue to pour into your life. Her expectation was, God, you got to do it, because you said you would. Her expectation was, God, you said that if I expected it, it has to keep coming. Her mission was to expect God to do what he said he's going to do. And I asked somebody this morning, are you still expecting God to move in your situation? Are you still pouring? Expecting God to fill it? Are you still pouring? Trusting that as long as the vessels are available, that it will be met. Are you still pouring? I don't know what it is you came in with this morning, but God told me to tell you that if you make room for him, expect it. He will continue to pour. If you open up, he will continue to pour out blessings you will not have room enough to receive. If you open up, God will do the supernatural and the miraculous in this place. If you open up and trust him, take your hands off of it and trust him, God will exceed your expectations. I just came to let someone know this morning that the Bible says that if you have the faith the size of a mustard seed, that you can say, mountain, move from here to there. And the Bible says, not me, the Bible says it has to move. I don't know if you know what a mustard seed is, but a mustard seed is so small that it fits under your fingernail. But when you take a mustard seed and you plant it in the ground, a mustard seed produces a tree that is so strong and so rooted that birds have spaces to make their nests. And so if God can take something the size of a mustard seed and transform a life, Asbury, it's time for us to get our mustard seed faith. Because if we step out with mustard seed faith, God will keep pouring and 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 pouring. I just came to tell someone this morning that God is our provider. Why don't you give God a hand clap of praise this morning? God is our provider. The doors of the church are now open. This is a time that we invite those not just to a church,